Xin chào những cô chú. Ông chúng đây, bác cả tổ cái chúng ta cái này thì xã Mạc Ca, sẽ đập xã Thái Căm lại chúng niên, David Chandler chúng bác tổ, là chỉ cái bác tổ đi, ông chúng đây xong một cô bị ca từ bị từ vì ca bị cái đấy, thì bây miền Âu ca nông ca xã Xu ở đó nẹ chúng niên như lúc này, và sân ba miền Thâm Nùa xong mình chơi.
សូមអរគុណលោកប្រធាននិងសូមគោរពលោកប្រធានសូមគោរពលោកចៅក្រមជាតិនិងអន្តរជាតិនិងសូមគោរពអង្គសវនាការទាំងមូលខ្ញុំបាទសូមអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យជួយបញ្ជាក់សារជាថ្មីពុទ្ធពឹកមិញលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យបានបញ្ជាក់ហើយតែខ្ញុំមិន មិនបានក្តាប់ទេមិនបានយល់បញ្ហានឹងអញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំសូមឲ្យលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យជួយបញ្ជាក់អំពីស21មួយស្ថាប័នស្វ័យយ័តដោយលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យព្រឹកមិញនេះបានបញ្ជាក់ថាវាស្វ័យយ័តវាមានធាតុផ្សំជាច្រើនធាតុរបស់វាច្រើនក៏ប៉ុន្តែក្នុងធាតុច្រើនហ្នឹងខ្ញុំបានយល់មួយចំនួនហើយប៉ុន្តែនៅ3ធាតុដែលខ្ញុំមិនច្បាស់ឧទាហរណ៍ទី 1 លោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យបានបញ្ជាក់ថាក្តាសណាមបានស្ដីថារបាយការណ៍អីទាំងអស់ហ្នឹងត្រូវបញ្ជូនទៅថ្នាក់លើណែវាស្វ័យយ័តធម្មថាអានឹងវាបញ្ជូនទៅថ្នាក់លើអញ្ចឹងមានតែគុកដតីទៀតវាបញ្ជូនទៅថ្នាក់ក្រោមព្រោះអានឹងវាខុសគេបានវាស្វ័យយ័តកើតនេះជាចំណុចទី 1 ដែលខ្ញុំមិនសូវយល់ចំណុចទី 2 ថាគុកដតីទៀតមិនដឹកនាំជាអ្នកកម្ពូលដោយសុនសេន គុកដតីទៀតមិនដឹកនាំជាអ្នកកម្ពូលដោយសុនសេនអញ្ចឹងងំឲ្យខ្ញុំឆ្ងល់ថាតំបន់នីរដីតាមុកគាត់ដឹកនាំហើយតាមុកក្តាប់គុកតំបន់នីរដីហើយតាមុកជាបុគ្គលទី 4 ក្នុងមជ្ឈិមបកចំណែកសុនសេនតូចជាងតាមុកទេគឺជាបុគ្គលទី 7 នេះជាចំណុចមួយទៀត ហើយមួយទៀតដូចជានៅបោពីសោយ័នហៅភឹមជាបុគ្គលទី 3 ក្នុងមជ្ឈិមបកគាត់ក្តាប់គុកនៅបោពីហើយជាពិសេសមួយទៀតនោះឯកសារដែលថាមានសិទ្ធិសម្រេចកំទេចក្នុងជួរនិងក្រៅជួរក្នុងនោះខ្ញុំឃើញថានៅតំបន់ឯករាជ្យតំបន់ឯករាជ្យគឺត្រូវអចិន្ត្រៃយ៍សម្រេច អញ្ចឹងអចិន្ត្រៃយ៍នឹងអចិន្ត្រៃយ៍ណាគឺអចិន្ត្រៃយ៍មកឈឹមប៉នឹងគឺប៉ុលពតអញ្ចឹងតើតំបន់ឯករាជ្យនោះមកឈឹមប៉ក្តាប់គុកទៅក្នុងឬទេអចិន្ត្រៃយ៍នឹងក្តាប់ឬទេនេះដល់នាំឲ្យខ្ញុំឆ្ងល់ហ៎នៅចំណុចមួយទៀតធាតមួយទៀតថាស21វាជាស្ថាប័នស្វ័យយ័តត្រង់ថាស21មានទូរស័ព្ទ មានអង្គលីលេខឯគុកដតីទៀតគ្មានចុះតំបន់ស្វ័យយ័តតំបន់ឯករាជ្យដូចប៉ុលពតក្តាប់តំបន់ឯករាជ្យនឹងគុកធំតើតំបន់ឯករាជ្យនឹងមានអង្គលីលេខទេតំបន់ឯករាជ្យនឹងមានទូរស័ព្ទទេខ្ញុំវាអត់បានដឹងដូច្នេះខ្ញុំសូមឲ្យលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យមេត្តាជួយបញ្ជាក់ចំណុចទាំងអស់នេះសូមអរគុណ
Well, I'll do the easy answer first. I didn't do any research on the prisons in the independent zone. My book was about S21. So I don't know what sort of facilities these prisons or this prison had. I haven't seen anywhere that other people know that. Also, I think in the southwest, Tamok had more autonomy than the leaders of the other zones. He was a very powerful person, number 3, as you say, in the hierarchy, and was not going to take orders. from anyone except Pol Pot, whom he later, of course, as we know, was instrumental in smashing himself.
Now,
by autonomous, I really meant that these, that as far as I know from information that I gathered when I was writing my book, that the defendant was given considerable freedom of action about how to proceed. People were saying, did he invent the six copy policy? Did he invent this policy of consolidating the Ksai Kabot, the strings of traitors? I think probably did. This is part of his efficient operation. But I don't think there was so much day-to-day supervision by outside authorities, and I don't think the evidence has come forth that Sun Sen, his supervisor through 77, consulted with him on a daily basis or even a weekly basis. This is what I meant by autonomous. I'm not sure there was other questions I may have missed, but as I say, I cannot speak about the prisons in the independent zone if that was controlled by the party center. That's a piece of information I had not known before, and I know very little about these prisons or this prison, whichever was involved, and I'm not sure the documents have come down to us about them to say how they functioned. If they have, they certainly were not in my view when I was doing my work. Well, if something was not publicized, I can't base my statement on a document. I mean, it's the absence of documents that suggests the thing wasn't publicized. This is through 1977. You had Phnom Penh Radio was broadcasting, Vietnamese Radio was broadcasting. These broadcasts were monitored and published by the BBC and by the United States. Not a mention of this was happening. That's where I drew my evidence that there was not being publicized. The publicity began in 1978 after the breakdown of diplomatic relations with Vietnam, after Vietnam's attack into Cambodia in late 1977, which was not publicized by either party until they withdrew in January 78, and then the Khmer declared a great victory over the Vietnamese at that time.
Now,
there were certainly, these conflicts were publicized after the war broke out in the open in 1978, but they were not publicized in 1977, which is the period I was talking about. The only archive which I was aware of when I was writing the book was the one from the southwestern prison, which was sizable, but by nowhere means as sizable as a surviving archive from S21. I was able to say that this, as a surviving archive, was extremely large and larger, as indeed it was, than any other archives that had survived that I was aware of. Now, I don't think archives have survived. I may be missing, I may not know this, I may be wrong, but I don't think extensive archives have survived from the provincial prisons, archives of the extent of the archive discovered at S21, which not only included over 4,000 confessions, but hundreds of pages of administrative documents, rosters of prisoners, lists of executions, study session documents, self-criticism materials. This is a massive, massive document archive, as any visitor to DC CAM can see. And I don't think, and I'd be welcome to withdraw this if I can find evidence that there's any archive anywhere near as large that has been cited by anybody in Cambodia since. There may have been archives as large as this that have disappeared. I have no way of knowing.
សូមអរគុណលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យតាមការស្រាវជ្រាវរបស់លោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យតាមការសិក្សារបស់លោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យលើស21តើលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យ
I don't think he did have that authority. The arrests were made when people were sent to him. As far as I'm aware, he didn't have authority to make arrests in the countryside. He may well have been able in a position to send names to figures in the countryside for them to decide whether a person should be arrested or not. But to my knowledge, and I think he could probably amplify this himself in a statement, or contradict it. I don't think he had authority to arrest, and I think that was not an authority that he sought that I'm aware of either.
សូមអរគុណលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យជួយបញ្ជាក់ថែមទៀតតាមការស្រាវជ្រាវរបស់លោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យតើជនជាប់ចោតអាចបញ្ជាឲ្យយកអ្នកទោសទៅកំទេចដោយគ្មានការបញ្ជាពីថ្នាក់លើដែរឬទេ
Well, for one thing, the answer to your question is we have none of the surviving superior orders. If they existed, they have not survived. They would make the work of this tribunal a lot easier if we had. Please smash, sign Pol Pot. We have nothing like that that survived. I think the mandate that the defendant had at S21 was to see to it that everyone who came into that prison left it for execution. That was his mandate. That was never withdrawn by higher authority, and therefore I don't think he had to seek higher authority to supervise a system in which he had no choice about who got killed and who didn't. Everybody got killed, no matter what they'd done or who they were. So it was not a question of seeking higher authority on individual bases. I think and here again I may be wrong, because I, of course, was not present at the time. I think where he sought higher authority for certain activities was when higher authority was interested, or particularly interested, in a given prisoner. So he would want to know from Son Sen particularly, how should this particular prisoner be treated? What questions should he be asked? And so on. And these dialogues, of course, have not survived, but this would be the places where he would have sought authority, but it would never have been authority to kill the person. That went without saying. Everybody who went in there, from the smallest child to the highest member of the Communist Party, had the same fate.
អ្នកដែលបញ្ជូនមកទាំងអស់នោះត្រូវមានជោគវាសនាទៅមួយដូចគ្នានោះឯងសូមអរគុណលោកសាសាចារ្យខ្ញុំសូមសួរមួយសំណួរទៀតព្រឹកមិញលោកសាសាចារ្យបានមានប្រសាសន៍ថាពេលនោះគឺពេលដែលជនជាប់ចោតនៅជាប្រធានស.21គឺពេលនោះជនជាប់ចោតមិនហ៊ានសរសេរឬក៏មិនហ៊ាននិយាយថា ខ្លួនមិនពេញចិត្តនឹងការងាររបស់គាត់ទេណាជនជាប់ចោតអត់មានឯកសារអីមួយថាគាត់ហ៊ានសរសេរទេណាគាត់មិនពេញចិត្តនឹងការងាររបស់គាត់គឺអត់មានទេព្រោះបើជនជាប់ចោតហ៊ានសរសេរឬនិយាយបែបនេះនោះគឺជាការសម្លាប់ខ្លួនឯងលោកសាសាចារ្យមានប្រសាសន៍ព្រឹកមិញថានោះគឺជាការសម្លាប់ខ្លួនឯងអញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំសូមសួរលោកសាសាចារ្យថាតើលោកសាសាចារ្យនៅតែប្រកាន់គំនិត
Certainly, I don't see any reason to. I haven't seen anything since this morning that would cause me to change my mind.
សូមអរគុណលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យដែលបានជួយបញ្ជាក់ក្នុងរឿងនេះ
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bon après-midi, Monsieur Chandler.
David Chandler.
Merci de votre patience devant ce feu roulant de questions. J'ai encore quelques questions à vous poser.
Je vous
remercie vivement d'être venu jusqu'à cette
barre.
Votre témoignage est d'une importance capitale pour la manifestation de la vérité.
Ma
première question sera un peu générale à partir du titre français de votre livre
S21
ou le crime impuni des Khmer Rouges. Vous êtes aujourd'hui témoin devant ce tribunal à vocation internationale, ce tribunal qui mène le premier procès des Khmer Rouges. Alors,
Monsieur
Chandler, est-ce que vous pensez que ce procès va pouvoir servir l'histoire?
Thank
you for the question. I think it's probably the largest one that's been asked me today, and I've been asked some pretty large questions. The easiest answer is there's no way of telling, but I'm not going to say that answer. I think the trial, at least as it's developed so far, and so far as I've been in touch with reading about it and so on, has a use by confronting the defendant, and I hope confronting subsequent defendants with some evidence that they will be in a position to accept or deny, and that this confrontation is one that has never happened with the Khmer Rouge. They did what they did. They walked away from it. And now the higher, not the current defendant, but the higher brothers, the ones who are still alive, say they had nothing to do with anything that occurred. I think it's important that all of these accused people face up to their responsibilities to the truth of what happened when they had positions of power. To question that evidence if it's unreliable or false, and to allow the Cambodian people, at least some of them, to have some awareness of what had happened in a scale wider than the horrific stories anybody in this room can pick up from any Cambodian person over 40. Except, of course, those over 40 who played an active role in the Khmer Rouge administration.
Merci. Et ma question complémentaire. Personne depuis ce matin dans ce prétoire, personne n'a évoqué le fait que l'accusé plaide coupable et reconnaît sa responsabilité. Vous qui avez travaillé longtemps sur S21, est-ce que vous considérez que le fait pour l'accusé de reconnaître sa responsabilité sert l'histoire?
ការទទួលស្គាល់របស់ជនជាប់ចោតជនជាប់ចោតអំពីការទទួលខុសត្រូវរបស់គាត់បម្រើដល់ផលប្រយោជន៍ប្រវត្តិសាស្ត្រដែលទីចំឡាយ
I was extremely ខ្ញុំ moved and impressed by that admission of responsibility, which seems to me pretty close to unique in survivors of that administration. Not surviving victims, surviving active members.
រងគ្រោះដែលរួចរស់មានជីវិតទេប៉ុន្តែចំពោះអ្នកដែលមានសកម្មភាពក្នុងរបបនោះផងដែរ
Merci.
Mettez-vous.
Pour autant, nous essayons et vous nous y aidez de comprendre par la confrontation justement quel était le degré de responsabilité de chacun. Vous avez compris aux questions des procureurs, aux questions des parties civiles, que malgré la reconnaissance des faits de l'accusé, on essaye encore, j'allais dire, d'en rajouter. Et de, on essaye de démontrer qu'il avait plus d'autonomie que ce qu'il dit. Alors vous pardonnerez à la défense, à son tour, de reprendre dans votre livre ce qui nous paraît exprimer la réalité de ce qui s'est passé. Je veux reprendre juste quelques points, et notamment la chaîne, je dirais, de commandement, la place à laquelle était Duc. Vous dites dans la version française de votre livre, paragraphe 37, premier paragraphe, en parlant de Son Sen, ses nouvelles responsabilités incluaient celles du Santébal. Son Sen le dirigea de très près. Il lisait et annotait de nombreux aveux Il dirigea également des sessions d'études pour les cadres de S21, au cours desquelles il discutait de ses objectifs, des interrogatoires et de l'usage de la torture. Au deuxième paragraphe de cette même page, vous ajoutez de nombreux documents communiqués par S21 au centre du parti, passé entre les mains de Son Sen. On a retrouvé des dizaines de notes que Duc lui avait adressées, ainsi qu'une grande partie de ses réponses. Elles indiquent l'attention caractéristique d'un enseignant aux détails et au zèle, et un zèle révolutionnaire indéfectible. Yunyat, sa femme, également ancienne enseignante, travaillait beaucoup avec lui et avait aussi accès à certaines dépositions. Seulement, votre commentaire, si vous en avez, sur ces passages de votre livre, est-ce que ici vous pouvez confirmer que Duc était bien le subordonné de Son Sen et que Son Sen avait la haute main sur le
Santébal? Mien amnaj pdaj prot te le Santébal muy ni.
Certainly, that was true. I never meant to say that the defendant had complete autonomy in his activities. He was certainly under Son Sen. I don't think Son Sen, the number of confessions that we have his annotations on, is quite small compared to the number we have the defendant's annotations on. I think the defendant was careful to send things to Son Sen when there was matters of confusion or a certain importance in the prisoner. But yes, to answer your question, the answer is of course. I mean, this was not a rogue operation. This was a operation following a distinct command. But as one of the previous questions suggested, it looks as if in the kind of chaotic way that DK often operated, that Tramok, higher than Son Sen, had genuine autonomy in the southwest and was not. Son Sen, although supposedly in charge of prisons there, was not in a position and probably was unwilling in any case to take over those operations. So, the answer to your question, of course, is yes, but I mean, there's give and take around at other points.
Oui, tout à fait. Et plusieurs de mes confrères ont fait référence aux déclarations à cette barre de M. Hutchison, qui était moins mesuré que vous, il faut bien dire, et j'avais regretté qu'il se présente comme expert, tandis qu'il appartient au bureau des coprocureurs. Mais il avait dit. Il avait cité cette marge de manœuvre en disant qu'elle faisait partie de la ligne du PCK. Et il nous avait rappelé que les statuts du Parti communiste du Kampuchea demandaient à ses cadres de faire preuve d'innovation. Effectivement, quand on se reporte à l'article 4 de ces statuts, il est intitulé « La ferme position révolutionnaire dans la décision, la direction et le travail du parti », il est indiqué « Il faut posséder la notion et l'attitude de gestion du travail proche des masses, au sein du syndicat, de la coopérative et de l'armée révolutionnaire et avoir l'initiative de créativité autonome et avoir le dynamisme et l'intensification bouillonnante continuelle. Donc, est-ce que, quand vous parlez vous-même d'enthousiasme de Duc, et on ne peut que vous suivre, est-ce qu'il n'était pas aussi, avec cet enthousiasme, dans la ligne du parti?
Oh, certainly. It wasn't just that it was part of the party line. It was a part of the party line that the defendant had absolutely no trouble accepting. It suited his own inclinations and his own abilities. And he was a revolutionary party person. There was no way that you could have deviated from the party line and still retain his revolutionary authenticity. So sure, I mean, he was doing not only what was expected, but what he wanted to do. They coincided because you're not independent from the party. You and the party are one force.
Alors, pour autant, est-ce que ça excluait qu'il soit lui-même à un moment donné inquiet, voire terrorisé? Vous avez rappelé, c'est à la page 66 de votre livre, ce changement inaugura le règne absolu de la terreur qui se maintint jusqu'à l'effondrement du Kampuchea démocratique. Si on se rappelle que le prédécesseur de Duc, Nat, a fini à S21, si on se rappelle que Von Wett, un de ses anciens supérieurs, a fini à S21, quand Duc dit, j'ai été à la fois acteur et otage de ce régime, est-ce que c'est quelque chose qui vous paraît cohérent? Il dit, j'ai été acteur et otage de ce régime criminel. Et il rappelle qu'il assume ses responsabilités. On essaie juste d'expliciter comment ça a fonctionné.
Thank you. The defendant is now saying, as he not only has a right to do what he's chosen to do, and I admire him for that he was the hostage and actor of a criminal regime. I think, just from the documents that I've studied, I think the awareness that the regime was a criminal regime did not came in 1978, this period when he has said that he began to get disillusioned, his friends and patrons were coming into the prison, he just couldn't see the point of it all. I think it's all very authentic what was happening. But I think we can't, and he was also frightened because the final machine gun bursts, if you like, of the regime seemed extremely arbitrary. There's quite a lot of evidence that had the Vietnamese not invaded, that Son Sen himself would have come under the gun. Generalized fear, I think, was everywhere by that stage. The statements of Pol Pot, insofar as they've been recorded, made absolutely no sense whatsoever. He felt that he was being attacked by members of the Warsaw Pact, etc. So, in these closing months, maybe the closing 6 months, I'm not sure, I think you have a documented series of regrets on the part of the defendant. These did not extend to his, and I'm not being accusatory here, and I know I'm getting outside the frame of the tribunal, but these regrets did not extend to his deserting the movement in 1979 or 1980. He stayed with the movement. He was still a I guess, considered himself to be a revolutionary. Of course, he'd been frightened at this period. And this is also consistent with just making sense of what was going on.
Merci. Vous, vous évoquez en fait dans votre réponse un autre aspect que vous avez développé ce matin, sur lequel vous insistez plus encore dans, dans votre livre, c'est la paranoïa qui avait atteint visiblement les leaders. Je vois à la page 98-99 de votre livre, toujours édition française, suivant à la lettre les ordres du centre, Duc et ses collègues sapèrent la force militaire du Cambodge, démantelèrent sa structure administrative et détruisirent même le parti. La machine meurtrière de S21 n'avait pas de frein. La paranoïa des leaders du Kampuchea démocratique ne connaissait pas de limites. Vous ajoutez effectivement à la page 134, comme je l'ai suggéré plus haut, les aveux extorqués à S21 servait aussi un objectif psychologique en objectivant les délires paranoïaques des dirigeants du Kampuchea démocratique. Avez-vous juste un commentaire ou est-ce suffisant avec ce que vous avez dit ce matin?
Paranoïa began at the center and spread down through the ranks.
I think trying
to work my way through the rest of your question. Certainly, I would stand by my comment that the machinery of DK didn't have any, but it had breaks in the sense that when the regime decided very belatedly to established diplomatic relations with several countries to give a generalized amnesty to the population, which none of the population heard about, when they decided to slow down the rate of intake into S21 while they were engaged in a full-scale war against Vietnam, which must have been, I think, for the Cambodians, really quite terrifying if they had thought for a second of what they'd taken on, the most experienced combat army in Asia with a population of 70 million people. In this whole atmosphere of 1978, I think there is a sort of an attempt to slow down some to diminish the extent of the cruelties and activities which the regime was noted for, and to try and balance the boat, as it were, as it was heading toward disaster. But the paranoia of the leadership continued to have no bounds, because if indeed the most dangerous enemies were those that were invisible, it could never stop, because you can't see them, and they're out there trying to get you. So this is kind of a ragged answer to your good question, but it's the best I can do at the moment.
Merci.
Vous
beaucoup. Un autre sujet que vous avez abordé, notamment avec Madame la Juge Galright, c'est la question de la politique du secret qui est avec pour à S21, mais aussi d'une manière générale. Sur S21, à la page 34 de votre livre, vous rappelez les gardiens n'avaient pas le droit de suivre les interrogateurs dans les pièces réservées aux interrogatoires ou d'ouvrir les fenêtres pour regarder les ennemis interrogés. Et je crois me souvenir que dans d'autres passages, vous rappelez que les interrogateurs n'avaient pas le droit de parler entre eux. Plus généralement, à la page 31, vous dites ceci, le pays entier est vite devenu un environnement scellé, isolé du monde extérieur. Les responsables de S21 étaient eux-mêmes sous la surveillance du centre du parti, tenu également secret, et en tant que membre d'un régime indépendant, ils travaillaient sous la règle de la discipline militaire. Et au paragraphe suivant, là où vous parlez de l'institution totale, on en a parlé ce matin, vous rajoutez que la mission de S21 était de protéger le centre du parti. Des commentaires supplémentaires sur la politique du secret d'une manière générale ou en particulier à S21?
Not really. I mean, I think it was pretty clear to the defendant that secrecy was the hallmark of the entire regime. There was no point or no opportunity to take issue with that policy. As we said earlier, one of the tragic outcomes of that was that no matter what people had done, or no matter why they'd been arrested, or no matter how old they were or how young they were, everybody who went in the gates of that prison was killed, I think, to a large extent to keep the existence of the prison from being known outside its walls. That's why the guards themselves weren't allowed to go home or whatever to take any vacations and so on. I think the secrecy got really completely out of hand, but then so did everything else. I mean, everything was going out of hand at the same time. As the place was coming apart, the enemies multiplied, the paranoia intensified, the prophecies became self-fulfilling. Because if so many guilty people, Taoists in Cambodian, were pouring into S21, well, then surely the extent of genuine conspiracies was enormous, and surely you just had to keep going, and the secrecy aspect was never withdrawn. As I said, I think this morning, Nguyen Chi had one of the rare frank interviews that he was able to give, because he gave it to a sympathetic Danish delegation, said that secrecy was absolutely, the exact words in my book, I can't remember, was exactly crucial or central to everything the party did, and that secrecy was, if you like, the logo or the motto of the CPK.
Merci beaucoup. Avant d'aborder mes dernières questions, je voulais juste vous dire, Monsieur Chandler, je regrette que les coprocureurs et même les avocats de la partie civile ne vous aient pas alerté sur une difficulté de preuve qu'il y a dans le dossier qui n'est pas fondamentale. Par rapport à ce que vous dites à la page 40 de votre ouvrage sur le plan ultime. Alors, nous n'avons pas le temps, si M. le Président tout à l'heure m'accorde un peu plus de temps, on vous projettera à l'écran le document qu'ont produit initialement les coprocureurs. Ils avaient indiqué initialement que ce document correspondait à ce que vous appelez dans votre livre le plan ultime. Et ensuite, les coprocureurs ont retiré cette demande en disant ils n'ont pas dit on s'est trompé, mais ils disent effectivement ça n'est pas le document écrit par Douc, il s'agit en réalité du carnet de Pon. Et Douc confirme d'ailleurs en disant que son écriture et celle de Pon se ressemblent. Alors, c'est juste pour que vous ne repartiez pas sans que quelqu'un vous ait au moins informé qu'il y a eu cette question dans le dossier. Ce n'est pas mon travail, ça aurait été le rôle des procureurs de vous informer. Ils n'ont pas cru devoir le faire. Alors j'aborde pour ma part, M. Chandler, ce qui me paraît, comment dire, l'apport fondamental de votre livre à notre réflexion et à ces débats. Vous avez eu le courage, dans le dernier chapitre de votre livre, d'aborder la question de ce que vous appelez le crime d'obéissance. Et en ce qui me concerne, c'est le sujet qui m'intéresse d'essayer de comprendre. Pourriez-vous, en quelques mots, M. Chandler, expliquer à la Cour ce qu'a été ce qu'on appelle l'expérience de Milgram, dont personne ne vous a parlé depuis ce matin. Je le regrette.
Certainly,
the Milgram experiments took place in New Haven, Connecticut in the early 1960s, and what was involved was they asked, advertised in the paper for volunteers to come for interviews for which they were paid, I think $10, something like that, where they were meeting a psychologist, a man in a white coat, who sat them at a console with a series of electric buttons on it, and then proceeded to ask questions, grammatical questions or mathematical questions, on a microphone to a person supposedly located on the other side of the wall.
ຕ້ອງສົມອັນແນ່ຈຳນຽງອັດບາກວ່າໄມໂຄສົມ
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Merci, Monsieur le Président. Pour les besoins du transcript, donc, Monsieur Chandler, vous parlez dans votre livre de l'expérience de Milgram. Pourriez-vous en dire quelques mots à la Chambre? Je vous remercie.
The Milgram experiments, that come true?
Okay.
Were conducted by an academic psychologist named Stanley Milgram. And what was involved was getting volunteers through an advertisement in a newspaper to come and participate in a psychological experiment for which they'd be paid a small sum of money. University students were not allowed to participate. And what was involved was the volunteers were asked to sit at a console with various buttons on it, while the teacher or psychologist, a man in a white coat who was in charge of the psychological experiment, an authority figure, if you like, ask questions to a person who was supposedly
On the other side of a wall facing the console, there was a wall right in front of me, for example. And that person had to press a button, yes or no, to these questions. And whenever the person on the other side of the wall gave a wrong answer, the volunteer was supposed to press one of the buttons in front of him and administer a very mild electric shock to, if you like, punish or clarify the mind of the person on the side of the wall. Now, the whole thing was a setup. I'll explain why. The answers of the person behind the wall became increasingly wrong, and so the director or psychologist asked the volunteers to increase the voltage on the electric charge that was being administered to the person on the other side of the wall.
These
increases in voltage went past a series of flashing lights marked danger, do not go for, and the psychologist told me, never mind, it's okay, it's not going to happen. On the other side of the wall could be heard shouts, screams of pain, pounding on the wall to stop. And the point was of the experiment, I'll explain a little bit more in a minute, that 70% of the volunteers proceeded to obey the commands to increase the voltage past the danger system, which the board said, do not go past this thing, but which the psychologist said, it's okay, never mind, despite the cries and yells on the other side. Now, the people on the other side of the wall had no access to electric shocks. They were actors. Nothing was happening to them. However, they were programmed to increasingly give incorrect answers to the questions so that on the, my side of the wall, if you like, the voltage would keep increasing. Now, it was an extraordinary experiment. It was refined several times. Milgram changed the location, changed the participants, and found over the years that, over the year or two that he conducted this experiment, it was always pretty close to 60% of the volunteers sometimes changed in terms of their social position and so on, that followed the voltage right past the danger limit. The American Sociological Association, when these results were published, had an extraordinary meeting, or just a meeting, where they said experiments of this kind cannot be conducted ever again by a sociologist. These are too harmful to the, they thought, too harmful to the psyches of the volunteers. But the findings of the, Milgram's findings have never been questioned for accuracy. There have been similar experiments, not quite similar, but much experiments on obedience have been carried out by other psychologists elsewhere, and it's stood up enormously, this particular experiment. And it seems to me that this gets very close to the culture, not just of S21, but the culture of democratic Cambodia, where the people who gave the orders were accustomed to giving them, the people who received the orders were accustomed to obeying. There was no culture of, culture in Cambodia of questioning commands by someone who is in authority. In other words, questioning a military leader, a teacher, and so on. So I just used that experiment to show how, in a situation like S21, obedience plays into the horror of it all. You also find it played into the horrors of the so-called ordinary men that Christopher Browning dealt with, who were assassinating and
is a shooting of thousands of Jews in Poland in 1941 and 42. But, and I brought it up at the last part of my book because I don't think it explains everything, but I think it's useful to see to what extent people, I guess like us, I can say, because these volunteers were not criminals in any sense, we have built into us a sense of, well, if the man in charge says it's okay, it must be okay. This, of course, is a, feeds into the whole culture of DK and S21 in ways that I can't go into now, but would seem to be fairly clear.
Okay, thank you. 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 Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Comprendre ne veut pas dire justifier. Comprendre veut seulement dire tenter de comprendre. Et vous rappelez effectivement dans votre livre à la page 185 ce que dit notre chercheur Zygmunt Bauman. L'information la plus effrayante tirée de l'Holocauste et de ce que nous avons appris de ses auteurs n'était pas la probabilité que cela pouvait nous être fait, mais l'idée que nous puissions le faire. Et Monsieur Chandler, on vous a lu tout à l'heure, Madame le bâtonnier, vous a lu le dernier paragraphe de votre livre, mais pas la dernière phrase. Un temps, j'avais pensé ne vous poser que cette seule question, parce qu'il me semble que c'est la question fondamentale. Vous concluez ce dernier paragraphe par cette phrase pour trouver la source du mal mis en œuvre chaque jour à S21, nous ne devons finalement pas regarder plus loin que nous-mêmes. C'est bien ce que vous venez de nous dire.
នេះគឺជាអ្វីដែលលោកបានធ្វើការទីងសន្តាននៅក្នុងសៀវភៅរបស់លោកហើយជម្រាបជូនយើងខ្ញុំ
Well, I mean
ចម្លើយ
I stand by that last sentence ខ្ញុំប្រកាន់ចំណងរបស់ខ្ញុំនៅលើ inner for a judicial proceeding I still feel that our capacity to commit evil is, I think, greater than our capacity to commit good, because, as Bauman points out in another study, we're socialized into bad behavior. We're not socialized into good behavior. Good behavior is rebellious, basically. I mean, you're going against the grain. So, I stand by that sentence. This is not, of course, I use the word evil there. It does not exculpate people who do evil things because everyone else is capable of them. Because if so, you know, if we're all capable of killing people, then we should all go to jail. But that maybe only one person has killed someone in a trial situation. But I certainly didn't want to get this. I wanted to avoid, and I was angered by, no, it's too strong, too boastful. I didn't like people saying, look at those evil people over there. We would never. Well, who knows? Who knows what you do if you're in that situation? That doesn't mean that the people in that situation behave in any sense commendable. But I think holier than thou or better than others is one of the least admirable human characteristics.
It's a
Merci, Monsieur Chandler, et je vous confirme qu'effectivement, Duc reconnaît les crimes auxquels il a participé à S21. Je vous remercie. Et il présente ses remords sincères aux victimes.
ហើយជនជាប់ចោតគាត់មានការមានវិបដិសារីខ្លាំងណាស់
Filed a francophone, but this French edition of my book is an invented title. I did not call my book The Unfinished Crimes of the Khmer Rouge. That is never a phrase I would have used. But worse than that, from an academic point of view, all the notes were removed by the French editors in order to make room for explanatory prefaces and an explanatory postface written by two French scholars, you see, who can then make this book edible to the Anglo-Saxon fearing French public. It was enraging because this book needs its notes, and I think lots of the comments today have come from the notes, but they felt that the only way they could market this book is by making it into a sort of francophone sandwich with me in the middle and these two other guys. One of them, François Bizot, wrote a very gracious preface, but absolutely, I just want to make that point of the French edition because it's not the edition that I would ever use to So, I mean, you have to yourself, but don't cite it in the future without the notes. Okay, that's all I have to
separate comment.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Merci, Monsieur Chandler.
Merci, Monsieur David Chandler.
Thank you, Mr. President. I was going to raise this matter after the accused made his observations, if he was planning to do so. But we would like, and perhaps it's a good point to raise it now, because he may want to comment on it. We would like to put before the chamber the last plan, as referred to in Mr. Chandler's book, and it's, the number is E5/2.29, English 0023 8903 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 0028 it again. I just wanted to, for the record, to note that the comments by the defence, my learned friend, were a little bit tiresome in terms of the prosecution somehow being underhand in not raising the issue of the document. As Your Honours are very much aware, we're on strict time constraints in questioning, and we have to choose carefully what we need to put to a witness. But in any event, this was going to be raised today. The witness today, the professor, believed that the document that he saw, the last joint plan, was in fact written by Doig, or he saw a text written by the accused. However, as Your Honours are aware, in our filing on the 16th of March, we state that after an analysis of the document, looking at the handwriting of the accused in the prosecution office, it appears that the handwriting is in fact of a senior interrogator, Pon. And I believe I'm getting a nod from the defence that may well be the case. So regardless of that particular issue, it's an S21 document produced by the interrogation office there, and it's significantly relevant because it brings together, as the professor has said, all of the information for the last 2 years that seemed relevant to determine understand the perceived enemies during that period from the information they received. So we would like to put that forward into evidence. Maybe the accused might be able to clarify that in his observations if he wanted to do that, but regardless, we would like to put that before you.
Thank you.
Pas de problème de la part de la défense pour que ce document soit versé, en rappelant qu'effectivement il s'agit bien d'un document apparemment écrit par Pon et pas par l'accusé lui-même.
ជាតនេះអរជម្រះដល់ឱកាសទៅជំរាបចោតដើម្បីធ្វើការកត់សម្គាល់នៅសក្ខីកម្មរបស់អ្នកជំនាញ
លោកប្រធានជាទីគោរពដំបូងខ្ញុំសូមអនុញ្ញាតធ្វើការកត់សម្គាល់3 ចំណុចទៅលើវណ្ណកម្មរបស់លោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យ David Chandler ចំណុចទី1គឺខ្ញុំសូមគោរពដឹងគុណលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យ David Chandler អំពីការសង្កេតរបស់ខ្ញុំអំពីការសង្កេតរបស់គាត់ លើកិច្ចការរបស់ខ្ញុំក្នុងការតាមដានការបាត់ខ្លួននៃលោកទូសមុទ្រសូមជម្រាបដោយស្មោះត្រង់ថាការបាត់ខ្លួនរបស់តាទូខ្ញុំអត់ទាន់ជ្រះសាឡាទីរហូតដល់ថ្ងៃនេះលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យ David Chandler ឃើញស្នាដៃសួរចម្លើយនៅសំភីមួយលោកឲ្យតម្លៃនេះដល់ខ្ញុំខ្ញុំសូមថ្លែងអំណរគុណយ៉ាងជ្រាលជ្រៅ នេះពិតជាគុណធម៌របស់អ្នកស្រាវជ្រាវមួយដែលខ្ញុំសូមរៀនសរសើរចំណុចទី2ដែលខ្ញុំសូមថ្លែងអំណរគុណយ៉ាងជ្រាលជ្រៅដល់លោក David Chandler ដែរគ្រូបឆ្កែទាំងពីរនេះលោក David Chandler មានប្រសាសន៍ថាមិនមែនជាទស្សនៈរបស់កម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យទេឆ្កែមួយមានរូបហូជីមិញជាក្បាល ក្បាលឆ្កែនោះគឺរូបហូជីមិញឆ្កែទី2គឺរូបលៀនដុនចនសុនការសង្កេតនេះត្រឹមត្រូវណាខ្ញុំក៏ដឹងថាខ្ញុំធ្វើនឹងខុសពីព្រោះខ្ញុំរករូបរិសានិសុនអត់បានខ្ញុំឲ្យគេធ្វើដូច្នេះមិនមែនជារបស់អ្នកឈ្នះគឺបាក់ គឺពិតជារបស់ខ្ញុំដែលផ្ដិតរឿងនេះឡើងគឺព្រោះខ្ញុំរករូបរិសានិសុនអត់បានដូច្នេះការវិភាគដ៏វិសេសសាស្ត្រនេះធ្វើឲ្យខ្ញុំកាន់តែគោរពសរសើរដល់គុណធម៌របស់លោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យ David Chandler ទន្ទឹមនេះធម្មតាទេ ញ្ហាស្អីក៏ដោយវាមិនដែលឯកោទេលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យ David Chandler បានសរសេរប្រវត្តិរូបខ្ញុំទៅតាមសក្តិកម្មរបស់មនុស្សម្នាក់ដែលតាំងខ្លួនថាមិត្តភក្តិរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមពិតមិនមែនជាមិត្តភក្តិទេគ្រាន់តែឃើញគ្នាពីចម្ងាយការសង្កេតរបស់ខ្ញុំនៅទីនេះគឺអត់និយាយថាតើសក្តិកម្មនេះត្រូវប៉ុណ្ណាខុសប៉ុណ្ណាទេសូមជម្រាបបញ្ជាក់ប៉ុណ្ណេះនៅពេលដែលខ្ញុំតាមខ្ញុំចាំបើខ្ញុំមិនច្រឡំទេគឺនៅពេលដែលលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យឲ្យនិតថាយើប្រកលសិភៅរបស់លោកសាស្ត្រាមកក្បាលរបស់លោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យមកក្បាលដែលមានចំណងជើងថាបងទី1នៅក្នុងនោះខ្ញុំឃើញអេម៉ែល1ដែលលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យលោកបញ្ជាឲ្យនិតថាយើសួរប្រវត្តិរូបខ្ញុំឲ្យឆាប់ផ្ញើទៅឲ្យគាត់ដូច្នេះនេះជាគុណធម៌ទី1ទៀតទី3ដែលខ្ញុំសូមគោរពអ្នកស្រាវជ្រាវគឺអញ្ចឹងមិនដែលពេញចិត្តនឹងសកម្មភាពដែលខ្លួនទៅសេទៅថាវាពិតទាំងស្រុងទេចេះតែស្រាវជ្រាវតទៅទៀតដូច្នេះគុណធម៌ទាំង3នេះខ្ញុំសូមគោរពដឹងគុណយ៉ាងជ្រាលជ្រៅបំផុតដល់ឃើញស្នាដៃរបស់លោកអង្គពីស21នេះខ្ញុំសូមជម្រាបថាខ្ញុំអរណាស់មានមោទនភាពខ្ញុំគិតថាវាជាផ្កាមកតងក្នុងចំណោមផ្កា100តងដែលរីកនៅក្នុងសួនច្បារប្រជាធិបតេយ្យជាមួយនឹងសាស្ត្រាចារ្យខ្ញុំលោក Michel Vickery ជាមួយនឹងសង្គមវិទូ Evening Government ជាមួយនឹងសាស្ត្រាចារ្យ Philip Short ឡាក់ដូច្នេះខ្ញុំអរមានមោទនភាពណាស់នៅពេលដែលលោកចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតលោកបញ្ជាឲ្យខ្ញុំទៅសេសេចក្តីអធិប្បាយអំពីស្នាដៃរបស់លោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យ David Chandler ខ្ញុំមានការពិបាកក្នុងចិត្តពីព្រោះសមត្ថភាពខ្ញុំតូចទាបដូច្នេះខ្ញុំទៅសេមិនកើតទេគិតចុះគិតឡើងខ្ញុំទៅសេបានតែ2 3ម៉ាត់អំពីអត្តបទដែលមាននៅក្នុងវណ្ណកម្មរបស់លោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យក្រៅពីនោះខ្ញុំសរសេរអំពីប្រវត្តិអុកតកម្មរបស់បកកុម្មុយនីសកម្ពុជាទៅលើប្រជាជនកម្ពុជាដែលខ្ញុំចែកជាពីរដំណាក់កាលទី1មុន30ថ្ងៃ30មីនាហើយដំណាក់កាលទី2ក្រោយថ្ងៃ30មីនាមុន30មីនាគឺបកកុម្មុយនីសកម្ពុជាប្រព្រឹត្តអុកតកម្មទៅលើអ្នករាជការចាស់ទៅលើទាហានចាស់ទៅលើប៉ូលីសចាស់ទៅលើប្រជាជននៅក្រុងរាជការចុងក្រោយនៃដំណាក់កាលនេះណាត់គេធ្វើប្រធានខ្ញុំជានោះក៏ប៉ុន្តែចាប់តាំងពីថ្ងៃ30មីនា1930ខ្ញុំឃើញឯកសារនេះខ្ញុំតក់ស្លុតនឹងអង្គការកម្មរបស់ខ្លួនទៅលើចិត្តប្រជាជនខ្លួនឯងជាពិសេសទៅលើប្រជាជនខ្ញុំទៅសេប្រវត្តិអង្គការកម្មរបស់បកកុម្មុយនីសកម្ពុជាក្នុងឋានៈខ្ញុំជាមនុស្សម្នាក់នៅក្នុងបកនេះដែលមានទស្សនៈចំពោះជាតិប្រជាជនខ្លួនឯងហើយទី2មកកំណត់ទី2ខ្ញុំចង់និយាយអំពីនៃសេចក្តីសារភាពរបស់ខ្ញុំនិយាយអំពីតើទ្រឹស្ដីប៉ុលពតជាទ្រឹស្ដីអីបាននេះខ្ញុំតែងតែនិយាយថាប៉ុលពតទេមិនមែនម៉ៅអីទ្រឹស្ដីរបស់ប៉ុលពតគឺទ្រឹស្ដីបោះពួកអាក្រុម4អ្នកហើយប៉ុលពតខ្ញុំមកបន្ថែមទៅទៀតខ្ញុំឲ្យឧទាហរណ៍នៅក្នុងនោះគឺក្រោយ17មេសាបន្តិចឆាងឈុនឈាវវាមករស្នាក់ជាសម្ងាត់នៅភ្នំពេញដូច្នេះសរុបមកសេចក្តីទសេរបស់ខ្ញុំនេះវាមិនមែនជាស្នាដៃអីធំដុំទេគឺជាសេចក្តីសារភាពទោះកំហុសរបស់ខ្លួនជូនជាតិប្រជាជនកម្ពុជាហើយរកប្រភពថាស្អីដែលនាំឲ្យជាតិប្រជាជនកម្ពុជាវិនាសអន្តរជាតិហិនហោចសពបែបយ៉ាងនេះដូច្នេះនៅចុងបញ្ចប់នេះលោកប្រធានជាទីគោរពខ្ញុំអត់មានអីទេគឺមានបំណងចង់សុំដាក់ឯកសារទាំង3របស់ខ្ញុំដែលខ្ញុំសារភាពជូនជាតិប្រជាជនកម្ពុជានេះជាសាធារណៈតាមមតិបាយរបស់អវតកខ្ញុំមានសំណូមពរទៅប៉ុណ្ណឹងសូមគោរពសូមចប់
សូមអញ្ជើញជនជាប់ចោតរុកឈើសូមបញ្ជាក់បានច្បាស់លាស់លើសំណើរបស់លោកអំបីមិញដែលថាសូមឲ្យក្តីឯកសារចំនួន3ដើម្បីដែលជាសេចក្តីសារភាពអំពីឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មផ្សេងៗដែលលោកមានការប៉ុនប៉ងសូមឲ្យអង្គជំរះបង្ហាញជាសាធារណៈហ្នឹងតើឯកសារហ្នឹងលោកបានដាក់នៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងរួចហើយឬក៏ជាឯកសារថ្មី
ជំរាបប្រសាសន៍លោកប្រធានឯកសារនេះខ្ញុំបានជូនទៅចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតដំបូងឯកសារនេះខ្ញុំសរសេរតាមបញ្ជីរបស់ចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតហើយខ្ញុំជូនទៅចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតវិញលេខឯកសារនេះគឺ A98 ទាំង 3 ភាសានេះ ភាសាបារាំង និងភាសាខ្មែរជាអក្សររបស់ខ្ញុំគឺលោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យ David Chandler
អរគុណបាទសូមគុជចុះដោយសារឯកសារដែលតំណាងសហប្រជាអន្តរជាតិបានស្នើសុំដាក់ចំពោះមុខអង្គជំរះហើយខាងមេធាវីការពារក្តីក៏មិនមានការតវ៉ាដែរនោះគឺយើងចាត់ទុកថាឯកសារនេះបានដាក់មុខដេញដោលនៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំរះហើយឯកសារអំបីមិញដែល ជំរាបចោតបានស្នើនេះគឺឯកសារដែលមាននៅក្នុងទំនងរឿងស្រាប់ហើយហើយឯកសារនេះក៏បានមានការពាក់ព័ន្ធនៅក្នុងការសួរដេញដោលពីព្រឹកមិញដោយចក្រមស៊ីវើខាត់រៃរួចហើយដែរអញ្ចឹងគឺអង្គជំរះយល់ថាឯកសារនេះគឺចាត់ទុកបានដេញដោលនៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនួយជំរះជាសាធារណៈរួចហើយ
Monsieur le Président, merci Monsieur le Président. Juste avant que vous clôturiez l'audience, je voulais indiquer respectueusement à la Chambre que je ne serai pas présent la semaine prochaine et que c'est Maître Canizares qui me remplacera à cette barre. Je vous remercie, Monsieur le Président.
ហើយមេធាវីកានេសារេសនឹងមកជំនួសខ្ញុំសូមអរគុណ
មកលើនេះដល់ទីបញ្ចប់ហើយអង្គជំរះគឺថាសំណាកាសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះគឺ ត្រូវផ្អាកត្រឹមនេះហើយសកម្មភាពនឹងលើកទៅបន្តនៅថ្ងៃច័ន្ទសប្តាហ៍ក្រោយគឺថ្ងៃទី 10 ខែសីហាឆ្នាំ 2009 ចាប់ពីម៉ោង 9 ព្រឹកហើយសកម្មកម្មបន្តនោះគឺនឹងធ្វើសកម្មកម្មចំពោះសាក់សីដែលនៅសល់ហើយមុននឹងបញ្ចប់នេះក៏សូមថ្លែងអំណរគុណដល់ លោក សាស្ត្រាចារ្យ David Chandler ដែលលោកបានចំណាយពេលវេលាដ៏មានតម្លៃហើយមកចូលរួមផ្ដល់សក្តិកម្មក្នុងនាមអ្នកជំនាញចំពោះមុខអង្គជំរះឡាតំបងតាមការអញ្ជើញហើយទោះបីជាលោកត្រូវប្រឈមនឹងការតាំងសំណួរពាក់ព័ន្ធជាមួយនឹងស្នាដៃរបស់លោកក្នុងការនិពន្ធ រឿងពាក់ព័ន្ធជាមួយនឹងមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខស.21នេះយ៉ាងណាក៏ដោយឃើញថាលោកមានការអំណត់អត់ធ្មត់ហើយអង្គជំរះមានការអរគុណដូច្នេះអង្គជំរះនឹងផ្អាកសកម្មភាពទាំងនេះឲ្យលើកបន្តទៅថ្ងៃ10ខាងមុខអនុរិយមន្ទីរឃុំឃាំងនាំ ជំរាបជូនទៅកម្មវិធីគុំខាងវិញហើយឲ្យនាំគាត់មកកាន់សាលាការនៅថ្ងៃទី 10 ខែសីហាឆ្នាំ 2009 មីលីម៉ោង 9 ព្រឹក